when I heard that beat. The Rockinitis just moved my feet.
Hi, cats and kittens. Welcome to Rockinitis. My name is Michael, what's with that beard, Willmore. And the show is Rockinitis, and my co-pilot here is Rob, that's a very nice beard, Frith.
Yeah.
At least yours is neat and tidy.
Yeah.
And mine ain't.
Yeah, well, I guess I get it trimmed a little more often
than I don't. Trimmed. I just kind of let it go.
Somebody was telling me they thought you should beat it.
My daughter thinks I should add ribbons.
Yeah, that would be good too.
And she keeps saying, how long are you going to let it grow, Dad? And I said, well, till this hair meets that hair, then I'm going to braid it. Anyway, the show today is on Buddy Holly, but it's basically on one of his tunes and one of his best tunes, Peggy Sue, The Story of a Song. Now, the song was originally written by Buddy Holly and his lifelong drummer, Jerry Allison, although the producer, Norman Petty, put his name under the song title on the record label in order to get in on the royalties.
He did that with pretty much every song.
Yeah, he said to the Crickets and Buddy Holly, he said, well, I'm friends with the disc jockeys, and this will help get the record
airplay. Yeah, they'll see my name, and they'll figure, oh, this must be
legitimate. They'll see my name, and they'll figure, oh, it must be a good record.
Yeah. Right.
And so then they'll play it. But, I mean, he tricked them.
Well, yeah, because when it came time to divvy up the royalties, that wasn't the reason for it. He wouldn't give up his royalties.
Exactly.
Anymore. Yeah.
So, I mean, he basically told them, gave them a big line, and they bought it. Now, you got the original Peggy Sue single there on Coral.
Yeah.
And what are the credits on it?
Well, that's the thing. That's the part I don't get. It says, I've got this original 78 too. It says Jerry Allison and Norman Petty. It doesn't say anything about Buddy Holly.
No, that's odd, isn't it?
It's really odd because Buddy had originally written the song about his niece.
Yes.
So obviously he wrote it. I mean, why would Jerry Allison write it about Buddy's niece?
Originally it was called Cindy Lou.
Yeah.
About his niece. And then Jerry Allison said, why don't we call it Peggy Sue because I'm trying to get in with this chick.
Well, he'd actually broken up with her.
Okay, he'd broken up with her. He thought
it
would
get them back together.
Get back in her good books.
Yeah.
If we did a song called Peggy Sue.
That's right.
Yeah. So he got him to change it.
Yeah. So, they probably I think Buddy probably had it written, and then in order to make the new title, probably Jerry worked on it and worked some things into the lyrics probably with Buddy to make it more of the Peggy Sue song, I would think.
Here's an album here by a Canadian group called the Crown Imperials, vocals Mike Weichel, and they do Peggy Sue on it. And can you take that out of there? Anyway, this is, I went to art school for 5 years, and this is a very good rendering. That's an excellent drawing there of Buddy Holly. That's just the way he looked, pretty much. And at the time that the song was out in 1957, when a song comes out, Billboard and Cashbox, they list all versions of it. So on paper, it looks like competing versions are also hits.
Oh, yeah.
But they may not be. Like the first version we'll hear is by Rusty York. And if you look at the back of the album, right down about where my finger is there, there's a listing in Cashbox or Billboard of the song Peggy Sue, number 2 or 3 on the hit parade there, and it lists the competing versions as well as Buddy Holly's original. So the competing versions were done like 2 weeks later.
Oh, yeah.
Buddy Holly would record it, get it out on the market. Somebody else would go, let's cover that, let's get our version out, and maybe it'll be a hit before the other version, and then we'll get in on it, and we'll get to do the hit.
Amazing how fast things happen then.
Yes,
isn't it?
And they did it very quickly. And another album here, let's see, the flip it around there. That's what Rusty York looked like. Now, he was from Newport, Kentucky, and his biggest hit was Sugaree, Sugaree, which was written by Marty Robbins, incidentally. And Sugaree, Sugaree sold about 500,000, and it was really quite a substantial hit in 1959. At this point, he was basically a complete unknown, trying to get in on the coattails of Buddy Holly's huge hit, Peggy Sue. So let's hear his version of Peggy Sue, and then we'll follow with a really wonderful version here by a guy called Jackie Walker. And first of all, though, we'll hear the Rusty York version of Peggy Sue. It's kind of a pedestrian kind of version. It's not really too distinctive, but you get to hear what a great song it is nonetheless. Rusty York, Peggy Sue, his version on the King record label, 1957.
If you knew Peggy Sue, then you'd know why I feel blue without Peggy, my Peggy Sue. Well, I love you, gal, yes, I love you, Peggy Sue. Peggy Sue, Peggy Sue, oh, how my heart yearns for you, oh, 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 Peggy. My Peggy Sue. Oh, well, I love you, gal. Yes, I love you, Peggy Sue. If you knew Peggy Sue, then you know why I feel so blue without Peggy, my Peggy Sue. Oh, well, I love you, gal. Yes, I love you, Peggy Sue. Peggy Sue, Peggy Sue. Oh, how my heart yearns for you, my Peggy, my Peggy Sue. Oh, well, I love you, gal. Yes, I love you, Peggy Sue.
That's Peggy Sue as done by Jackie Walker. It's got a really interesting background arrangement. It's kind of a clattering background arrangement. And his biggest hit was Only Teenagers Allowed on the Imperial record label, 1959. And there he is doing a cover version, a great cover version of Buddy Holly's Peggy Sue, about 2 weeks after Buddy Holly's original. So that came out 1957. And today we're basically getting into the story behind the song Peggy Sue. It was on Buddy Holly's self-titled 1958 LP. It originally came out on a single in 1957, and here's the original 78 there. And the original coupling was Peggy Sue on one side and Every Day on the B-side. Both songs were hits, originally on the Coral record label, and it went to number 3 on the Billboard Hot 100 and number 2 on Cashbox, and it was on the charts about 22 weeks, so we're talking a huge hit here. But it didn't come out on LP until Buddy Holly's solo LP. He still has the Crickets backing him up, but it's without the picks and the various vocal groups he used in the background, so it's got more of a solo sound. It's
interesting that the drums really what really makes that song.
Mm-hmm.
You know, even though Buddy was a guitar player, but Jerry Allison's drums are just amazing.
Oh yeah, and oddly enough, it's just the two of them on the record too.
And the thing is, Buddy Holly told Jerry that if he couldn't maintain that drum, the drum thing he was doing throughout, that he wouldn't rename the song.
Oh, so okay.
That was part of the deal in the studio. He says, if you screw up again, I'm going to change it back to the other one. So he made a point of, I think they did it in like 2 takes or something. I think it took 20 minutes to record that whole song.
Wow. There's an alternate take out that's out now that's actually
quite similar.
Yeah, that's
probably the first one.
Yeah, quite similar to it. But anyway, this is a really interesting picture here. I want to read something out of it. This is from the Rolling Stone Images of Rock and Roll, which is a big coffee table type book. Wonderful book. It's got great pictures in it. And there's a really great picture here of Buddy Holly.
You got it.
And if you just look at that for a second, I've got some stuff to say about it. picture Buddy Holly on a tour bus there, and he's accompanied by two people. It says, Buddy Holly, the photograph was taken by Lewis Allen, circa 1958, Rochester, New York. Allen caught Holly aboard the band bus. The other two passengers were probably members of a package show with whom Holly was touring. It was on such a tour in 1959 that Holly was killed when he chose to fly rather than ride in a bus like this. Okay, now, I can't believe it. This is Rolling Stone.
Yeah,
they're supposed to know what they're doing.
Exactly.
Okay, this, if you look at the picture, that's Jerry Allison.
And Peggy Sue.
With Buddy Holly. There's Buddy Holly in the back, Jerry Allison in the front, with Peggy Sue. I mean, that's a really significant photograph.
What a blunder to not know that.
And yet, here's Rolling Stone, who are supposed to know what they're doing. They don't even know who's in the picture.
Yeah.
That's unreal.
Yeah.
Anyway, interesting stuff. Great photo.
But that was nothing like the bus that they were on the year that they died.
No.
That was a deluxe bus compared to the one they were on.
Anyway, the song Peggy Sue has a lot of longevity to it. There's Billy Crash Craddock did a version. He covered the song in 1973 on his Mr. Country Rock album. And the Beach Boys covered the song on their M.I.U. album in 1978. And they had a single out of Peggy Sue, which made number 59, which was a very minor hit in 1978. Have you ever heard the Beach Boys version?
No, never have.
I never have either. But anyway, the biggest cover of it probably was in 1975 when John Lennon covered Peggy Sue on his rock and roll album in 1975. And
they were the biggest Holly fans, him and Paul.
And most of the cuts on the album are produced by Phil Spector, but this cut, oddly enough, is produced by John Lennon. So we'll hear John Lennon's great version of Peggy Sue. Now, John Lennon has double-tracked his vocal on it and does a bit of a reworking of it, a nice kind of a version of it. Not up to Buddy Holly's original, though.
No, it's pretty hard to beat that.
This was a great party album, though, in its day.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Because it had, the thing was nice, it was old
stuff. Back to basics, sort of.
Yeah, back to basics, but it was an old, like the source material was old because it was all oldies, but it was kind of updated and the sound was kind of modern.
And the fact that he did play all those songs when they were basically cover tunes, at the time, like, new songs. So, I mean, he kind of grew up at that same time. So it wasn't like he was doing some new fad or something. He was playing his roots of his early, formative years of music, all the stuff he loved.
Yeah, it's right in on it. You know, the roots of the Beatles or the roots of John Lennon are certainly Peggy Sue.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Anyway, Jerry Allison plays paradiddles on the drums. Right. You were mentioning the great drumming.
Yeah.
It's actually paradiddles, which is an exercise that the drummers do when they're learning. And he does it throughout the song. There's only two instruments on the record, oddly enough. Buddy Holly's guitar and Jerry Allison's drums played live in the studio.
And Nicky Sullivan was there, though.
Yes, Nicky Sullivan was there. We'll get to that in a sec. And Nicky Sullivan, have you got that picture of the crickets, Buddy Holly and the crickets with Sullivan in the group?
I have one here.
Yeah, good. Yeah, it used to be four of them, and then they whittled it down to a three-piece. And maybe you could put your finger where Nicky Sullivan is so people...
Nicky Sullivan's on the far left. That looks like the tallest fella there.
Yeah. Anyway, they were all from Lubbock, Texas, but he was from California. So the obvious choice, if you're going to get rid of a guy.
Yeah, keep the good old boys.
Keep the good old Southerners in there and get rid of him. Anyway, that's what happened, basically. But he was in the group at this time. And Peggy Sue was played live in the studio. So it goes Buddy Holly's chords, and then it does this clanging guitar break, and then back to chords. Now, what happened was Buddy Holly kept mucking it up when they were playing it because he couldn't switch his toggle switch fast enough.
That's right.
To get to the lead playing, because he had to flip the treble switch to play the electric lead for the solo. So Nicky Sullivan, who isn't even on the record, crouched down at Buddy Holly's feet, and when it came time to switch from that rhythm figure.
Yeah. Buddy would nod and say, okay.
Buddy would go like that, and then Nicky Sullivan reached up and flipped the toggle switch like that, and then Buddy Holly launched into that clanging guitar break.
Peggy Sue, well, I love you, gal. I want you, Peggy Sue.
And there's this weird humming, shifting, and throbbing sound effect on the record. Maybe you could put the 78 up here on the turntable. And we'll hear it the way it was originally issued. This is the original 78 issue of Buddy Holly's great Peggy Sue. And there's this weird throbbing sound effect on the record created by Norman Petty, who was their producer. He's at the controls in the control booth, and he's turning the echo chamber on again and off again in time with the music.
When they originally were were recording it, Jerry's drums were so loud that it drowned out everybody else on the record.
Oh yeah.
So they moved him out into the hallway, his drum set, so they could record it there to get it far enough away that it was a good balance for the vocals and the guitar and everything else.
So, oh yeah.
Yeah, he wasn't even in the same room. They had to use, I think, the intercom from the. Entrance hall, like the lobby of the recording studio, to correspond to each other from the studio to where the drums were.
Oh, they couldn't even see each other?
No, they couldn't see each other at all.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow. So they were basically both playing in different rooms.
Yeah.
And there's only two of them on the record.
That's right.
Wow.
Yeah.
Anyway, I've got a great version of Buddy Holly doing the song live in Europe at the London Palladium in March 1958. This is a collector's style LP on the Cricket record label, and this is Buddy Holly doing Peggy Sue live on stage. And if you'll note, he doesn't do that characteristic clanging lead guitar break. He just does an extension of the strumming that he's already doing, because he doesn't have Nicky Sullivan crouching down to flip the switch for him. Anyway, a great live version of Peggy Sue by Buddy Holly and the Crickets.
I love you, gal, yes, I love you, Peggy Sue. Peggy Sue, Peggy Sue, oh, how my heart yearns for you, oh, Peggy, my Peggy Sue. Oh, well, I love you, gal, yes, I love you, Peggy Sue.
So the really interesting thing is that even though on the record Buddy Holly is playing the clanging lead guitar break live, he couldn't play it live on stage. He could only play it live in the studio if there was someone there to flip the toggle switch for him. So anyway, we're basically dissecting one of the great rock and roll songs of all time about a great rock and roll lady. And she actually was a real person. And now she has a book out.
Yeah.
Whatever Happened to Peggy Sue? Now, she was right in there on the ground floor with the Crickets. She was born in 1940 in Olton, Texas, and she was in grade 12 in Lubbock, Texas, when Buddy Holly and Jerry Allison's song came out in 1957. And she went steady with Jerry Allison, and they double-dated many times with Buddy Holly, and they hung out at the Heidi Ho drive-in in Lubbock, Texas, and she attended Buddy Holly's sock hops, and even lent Buddy Holly some of her rhythm and blues records he could learn songs. And she married Jerry Allison after high school, and I've got a great shot of them. They were so close, these guys.
They were on again, off again, quite a few times.
Well, when they were married 11 years, and when they split up, Jerry Allison was on tour so much he hardly ever saw her. And when they split up, he's a great guy with a great sense of humor, and he goes, that was terrible when we split up. He says, I gave her some of the best weeks of my life. Because he hardly ever saw
her. This is on their honeymoon.
Yeah, that's they're on their honeymoon there in Acapulco, Mexico, 1958. And it's Buddy Holly and Maria Elena over here, and Jerry Allison and Peggy Sue Giron on their honeymoon, and they did their honeymoons in conjunction with each other.
They were originally going to get married on the same day, like a double wedding, but Jerry and Peggy Sue didn't want to wait that long because it kept getting postponed or something, so they jumped the gun and I think went someplace and got married one night.
Well, Peggy Sue has every right to write a book.
Oh,
she was there, and she was... Maria Elena was only married to Buddy Holly for 6 months.
Yeah.
So Peggy Sue actually knew Buddy Holly longer.
I think she'd only known him like about a month before they married.
Yeah, exactly.
It was like
so Peggy Sue actually knew Buddy Holly longer than Maria Elena did.
Oh, yeah.
And recently, there's a news item here where Maria Elena is suing Peggy Sue because she wants to think that she's got sole rights to everything to do with Buddy Holly. And doesn't want anybody else using his likeness or whatever for their own profit and stuff. So there's this news item there about how Peggy Sue is being sued by Buddy's former wife, Maria Elena.
There's an early one of those package tour things with the Buddy Holly and the Crickets over there on the left side.
Mm-hmm.
I think this one's from 57.
Mm-hmm. Is there any pictures of Buddy inside?
Yeah, there's one on top. Yeah, I showed one already, but there's another one, too.
Mm-hmm. I'll grab. See if you can get it out there. Anyway, Peggy Sue, let's see, where am I at here?
Well, when they were dating, when Jerry and her were dating, the family were really uptight that it was getting a little bit too hot and heavy.
Yeah.
So they sent her off to Catholic school in California.
Oh, okay.
And that's when he decided he wanted to get her back, and that's when he talked Buddy into changing the name.
Cindy Lou to Peggy Sue.
Yeah, that would help, because she was like in California, so I guess she figured that would be a big enough thing to impress her enough to maybe get things going again.
Okay.
Here's another cool picture.
Anyway, when Buddy Holly died in that plane crash in 1959, the Crickets regrouped, and she continued to travel with the group as they toured. And they eventually divorced. They were married for 11 years. She moved to Sacramento and married a roller rooter man.
Well, that's funny. That's where she was sent That's where she was sent to Catholic school.
Oh, okay.
So maybe they had relatives there or something.
Anyway, in 2001, she appeared on the TV talk show I've Got a Secret as a rock and roll lady. You know, about having a song written about her and all that. The Rock and Roll Hall of Fame proclaimed Peggy Sue as the first international rock anthem and one of the most popular and influential rock classics of all time. And in 1986, Buddy's answer song, Peggy Sue Got Married, became the title of a movie starring Kathleen Turner. He had written a sequel to it, which is about her getting married to Jerry Ellison, his best friend and his lifelong drummer. Not that.
And then, of course, Don McLean wrote the American Pie.
Okay,
and dedicated that album to Buddy Holly as well, which, of course, is about the when the plane went down with all the with Buddy Holly and the Big Bopper and Ritchie Valens.
Okay. Now, the complete undubbed apartment tapes are available on the box set, the vinyl box set, and all the songs in it, including Peggy Sue Got Married, are on there. Now, for commercial release, Buddy Holly, before he went out on that last fateful winter dance party tour, he had given a tape to Jack Hansen of the songs, his new songs that he had just written. And it was, I think, six songs on the tape. So Jack Hansen chose Peggy Sue Got Married as the first one and overdubbed them and did a great produced version for commercial release, which came out on a 45. Anyway, we'll hear what the released version of Peggy Sue Got Married sounded like as produced for record by Jack Hansen. Now, what he did is he tried to imitate the sound of the crickets. So there's that do-do-do, kind of deal going on in the background with his vocal group, which was imitating Buddy Holly's regular backing group, the Picks. And the backing has been kind of beefed up by studio musicians, so it sounds a lot like an actual released crickets record. Peggy Sue Got Married, which later became the theme song for the Kathleen Turner movie.
Please don't tell, no, 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 don't say that I told you so. I just heard a rumor from a friend. I don't say that it's true, I'll just leave that up to you. If you don't believe, I'll understand.
And that's the actual hit version of Peggy Sue Got Married. And as we mentioned, Peggy Sue Giron has now written her autobiography called Whatever Happened to Peggy Sue. She has appeared on BBC TV in England, Dutch TV, Telecom, German TV, and Geraldo and Opera TV shows. And she's become a celebrity speaker, a radio host, and columnist. All because there was a great song written about her one day.